Bryan Danielson is one of the most loved and respected wrestlers of the modern era, and he's one of AEW's biggest stars. Throughout his career, he has distinguished himself from everyone in the wrestling industry with his technical proficiency and his ability to connect with the fans and get himself over in any situation that he is faced with. Bryan Danielson is simply a once-in-a-lifetime talent and a cut above the rest. Once all is said and done, he will have a legitimate claim to be called the greatest of all time. And this is his story. Bryan Danielson was born in Aberdeen, Washington in 1981 to a therapist mother and a lumberjack father. Bryan's parents divorced due to his father's alcoholism, but Bryan showed a love for wrestling as a child, and this inspired him to start training to be a wrestler as a teen. He trained under Shawn Michaels, and he showed so much promise in his early days of wrestling that within 1 year of debuting on the independent circuit, he was offered a developmental contract by WWE, of which he accepted. Bryan Danielson honed his skill for professional wrestling in the WWE developmental system with the help of his mentor, William Regal. But unfortunately, after 18 months, he was released from his developmental contract in WWE. This release was unfortunate because Bryan was just on the cusp of joining the main roster to be part of the cruiserweight division. Nonetheless, Bryan Danielson pressed on and continued to wrestle on the independents, and this garnered him new opportunities, one of which was to wrestle in New Japan Pro Wrestling. Bryan wrestled in New Japan under the moniker of the American Dragon, and he achieved successes there as he won the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Tag Team Championship with Christopher Daniels. Bryan Danielson even toured several parts of the UK and Europe to hone his wrestling craft. Over in the States, Bryan Danielson hopped from indie to indie, but in Ring of Honor is where he truly made his name. In Ring of Honor, he made himself into a legend of independent wrestling. Bryan is considered to be one of the founding fathers of Ring of Honor, and he was with the company from the very first day they launched in the early 2000s. Everybody knows Bryan Danielson for his time in WWE and AEW, but in ROH is where he peaked as a pure wrestler, and he did his best work there. In ROH, Bryan Danielson proved that he's a natural in-ring general and that his wrestling IQ is extremely high with his masterful storytelling, creative offense, attention to detail, insane grappling, mind-blowing submissions, good match layouts, believable selling, interesting maneuvers, great technique, nuanced in-ring psychology, and just the basic little things. There truly aren't enough adjectives and superlatives in the English language to describe how good Bryan Danielson was during his time in Ring of Honor. Bryan Danielson could have interesting and compelling matches with anyone, even those who were far below his wrestling capability. Bryan always looked good in winning or defeat, and he always made sure to make his opponents look like $1 million. Many a wrestler have said that Bryan Danielson is a favorite to work with because of how easy he is to wrestle and how he always gives 100% no matter what. Bryan Danielson was like a wrestling robot at this point. Everything he did meticulously and for an actual reason. Bryan Danielson's versatility also showed here, as he could have great matches with wrestlers from various different styles. Wrestling just came easy to him and was effortless for him to put on really, really good matches. But not only did Bryan Danielson have an incomparable wrestling ability, he also had an innate but quiet charisma and charm about him when he was a babyface, but he could flip that switch and become the most despicable heel if he wanted. Through his masterful playing as a babyface or villain throughout his time in Ring of Honor, he always got a reaction out of the fans and he connected to them in some capacity. His heel character was especially outstanding as it showed his brash, cocky, and ruthless side that fans could not get enough of. Bryan Danielson also came out to Europe's The Final Countdown, which just made Bryan Danielson all the more special in the eyes of the fans. Bryan had a series of classics against the likes of CM Punk, Low-Ki, Christopher Daniels, Homicide, James Gibson, Samoa Joe, Nigel McGuinness, Kenta, Austin Aries, Chris Hero, Mara Fuji, and Morishima. In many of these matches, Bryan would often go over the 30 or the 60 minute time mark, thus popularizing the work rate style long match in the USA, which has become the standard in American professional wrestling today in order to have a 5-star match. But the difference is, Bryan was doing this before it was ever cool in the USA, which is testament to how ahead of his time he truly was. Bryan also went on a legendary 15-month title reign in Ring of Honor, where he defended the Ring of Honor World Championship 38 times. Bryan Danielson also won the Best Technical Wrestler Award 9 times in the Wrestling Observer Newsletter, which was so much so that they renamed Best Technical Wrestler Award the Bryan Danielson Award. He was that good. Bryan had achieved everything there was to achieve on the independent circuit. Inevitably, WWE came knocking on his door again, and he accepted, but could Bryan Danielson make it in the big bad world of the WWE? In wrestling, the term vanilla midget is used to describe wrestlers who are good technical wrestlers but believed to be too small and or too boring to succeed on a large stage. Signs of a wrestler being a vanilla midget are if they have a small stature, good technical wrestling, poor mic skills, and a rabid, stubborn internet fandom. Notoriously, Vince McMahon is on this same train of thought, as he has wet dreams over guys who are over 6'5" and over 250 pounds. Unfortunately, Bryan fit into almost all of these archetypes when he got into WWE for the second time. He's 5'8", a wizard at technical wrestling, and had a rabid internet fan base that consider him an indie darling. And even though he was good at promos and character work like he showed in ROH, he wasn't necessarily good at sports entertaining just yet. Because of this, Vince McMahon thought that Bryan Danielson could just be a good team player, and he never saw him as a top level guy. When Bryan got to WWE, they watered him down to a great extent. He was christened with a new name in WWE as Daniel Bryan, and they managed to take away the one thing that he was truly good at, professional wrestling, by having him compete in silly challenges week to week in NXT, as NXT back then was a sort of game show. It's fair to say that the odds were stacked against Bryan for his second stint in WWE, and soon that showed. While Bryan was involved in an invasion angle with him and the NXT rookies dubbed as Nexus, Bryan strangled Justin Roberts with his own tie, and that caused Vince to fire him because he deemed what Bryan did as too violent for their PG-rated show. This was unfortunate because Bryan had just made his WWE debut. After getting released by WWE for the second time, Bryan Danielson went back to the independent circuit and considered retiring, but WWE couldn't resist keeping their hands off one of this generation's most gifted performers. WWE then rehired him for a third time round. Bryan was not supposed to make it in WWE, but somehow through sheer will, determination, and natural talent, he managed to forge a path for himself in WWE. He was already a fan favorite in WWE because he was an indie darling, but he managed to captivate fans who didn't know much about him prior to WWE with his charm and by maximizing his time in segments or in the ring. WWE's style of wrestling is also very different to independent style wrestling, so Bryan had to adapt to the WWE style, and he did that seamlessly. Soon after he returned, Bryan's efforts were awarded as he won the United States Championship. Bryan continued to prove himself more and more in WWE, and he eventually won the Money in the Bank briefcase, which entitled him to a world championship shot at any time of his choosing, of which he cashed in on the Big Show to become the new world heavyweight champion. Not bad for someone who was pegged not to be a top level guy. But the problem is, while the fans were behind Bryan and loved what they were seeing, it didn't seem like management were behind him. This was evident at that year's WrestleMania, where he lost the world heavyweight championship to Sheamus in 18 seconds. This managed to piss the fans off to a great extent because they saw it as disrespectful to allow one of the world's best wrestlers to go out on the grandest stage of them all in such a humiliating manner. But Bryan had already proved himself. What more could he do to get the fans to love him and management to back him? The answer to that question is yes. Right before Bryan lost the World Heavyweight Championship, he began chanting yes repeatedly on the way to the ring and in promos in an attempt to get heat from the fans. But this chant morphed into something wilder than he would ever imagine. With one simple word, the Yes Movement was born. The Yes Movement, led by Daniel Bryan, orchestrated by the fans, was a movement that was aimed at letting WWE management know that Bryan was the guy that they wanted to see at the top of the company. The fans resorted to chanting yes every week in protest that Bryan be treated better by WWE. Vince didn't see how fans saw Bryan Danielson, and that led the fans to make their voices heard. Yes chants even hijacked many segments. Vince McMahon saw how much fans were behind Bryan, and he decided to have him win the WWE Championship over John Cena at that year's SummerSlam. But this title reign only lasted a few minutes, as Randy Orton cashed in his Money in the Bank briefcase to win the WWE Championship, which left the fans angered and frustrated once again. The more Vince tried to stifle and sabotage Bryan's momentum, the more popular he became amongst the fans, and the Yes Movement grew even further. Vince even tried to quell Bryan Danielson's momentum by turning him heel by having him join the Wyatt family. This just caused the fans to be even more rowdy and loud at shows, demanding that Bryan be the face of the company. So because of the backlash, Vince had to turn him babyface again. The Yes Movement got so popular, in fact, that it even crossed over into mainstream media like the NBA, NHL, MLB, and concerts in the UK and Europe. The Yes Movement had gone international. Bryan was simply too over for Vince to ignore, so he decided to go against his initial plan of Randy Orton versus Batista at that year's WrestleMania in the main event, and he inserted Bryan into that match. The fans' resting boners fully erupted when Bryan won that triple threat match and won the WWE WWE Championship and the World Heavyweight Championship. And there was a massive WrestleMania pop. Bryan winning at WrestleMania is a type of wrestling moment that will be discussed for decades and is arguably the greatest wrestling moment in the 2010s. Bryan had gotten himself over against all odds and had indirectly forced Vince Kennedy McMahon to book him to win the World Championships in the main event of WrestleMania. This was one of the most satisfying moments to watch in wrestling history. However, moments like this don't last forever. Soon after his iconic victory at WrestleMania 30, Bryan reported losing feeling in his right arm that required neck surgery to repair, and this forced him to relinquish both the world championships that he won at WrestleMania 30. Bryan then healed up and he returned at the Royal Rumble in 2015, but was eliminated much to fans' dismay, and they booed the rest of the match and the eventual winner, Roman Reigns. Bryan then won the Intercontinental Championship at WrestleMania, but he was forced to relinquish this due to his injuries. Bryan then announced his retirement from professional wrestling. Bryan suffered many concussions in his career, and this had caused him to have seizures, which made him hang up his wrestling boots. This was very sad to see. Bryan still, however, had a role as the general manager of SmackDown, but this just didn't feel right. He was born to be a wrestler, not the manager of a wrestling show. Because of this, he was desperate to get back into the ring. And so over the years, he went for procedures that would help him heal his brain. These procedures led him to being cleared by doctors all over the country to wrestle again. But unfortunately, the WWE doctor refused to clear him to wrestle. Bryan was longing for a return to wrestling, and he stated that he wanted to work for Ring of Honor New Japan Pro Wrestling, or CMLL, in Mexico. Bryan felt that he was being unfairly treated in WWE because they weren't clearing him to wrestle, so he requested to be released from his WWE contract. But unfortunately, Vince and Kennedy McMahon denied Bryan's request. Because of all of this, Vince finally obliged to let Bryan do the one thing that he loves most in the world: wrestle. And so he returned. Not long after he returned, Bryan Danielson turned heel and he won the WWE Championship for the third time against AJ Styles. Bryan's run as the WWE Champion was just such good shit. The Planet's Champion was an exaggerated and villainous version of his real-life personality. Bryan was a militant environmentalist vegan who berated WWE fans for the consumerism, environmental damage, and consumption of meat. This character truly engaged fans and got them booing him like crazy. This is testament to how genius Bryan is. At this point, the perfect character foil for Bryan was Kofi Kingston. Bryan's feud with Kofi started a similar movement to the Yes Movement for Kofi in KOFIMANIA. Their feud culminated at WrestleMania 35, with Kofi Kingston and picking up the win and becoming the new WWE Champion, which is also one of the most feel-good moments in WWE history. Daniel Bryan made it all possible by being such a great heel. After this, Daniel Bryan's attention switched to the Universal title as he entered into feuds with The Fiend and Roman Reigns. However, while all of this was going on, there was a wrestling revolution going on led by Kenny Omega, The Young Bucks, and Cody Rhodes, The Elite. They changed the status quo in wrestling by creating All Elite Wrestling, AEW, which was WWE's first legitimate competitor in almost 20 years. AEW was backed by billionaire Tony Khan, so they were able to build a very decent roster and get a very good TV deal. AEW are doing things differently. They were much more grittier and edgier than WWE. They also allowed their wrestlers to just be themselves and create their own storylines with non-scripted promos. For the fans on the outside looking in, they didn't feel that Bryan would go to AEW because he hadn't made in WWE. Fans loved him, he was being paid well, he was well respected, he was uplifting a younger talent, had a good relationship with Vince and WWE, and he also had relatively good booking. This was shown as he was booked in the main event of WrestleMania 37 against Roman Reigns and Edge. Even though he lost this match, it's still a big deal to be in the main event of WrestleMania for the second time in his career. From the fans' perspective, Bryan was happy in WWE, but in reality, this wasn't entirely true. It's not that Bryan wasn't happy in WWE, but he was feeling unfulfilled. Bryan even stated himself that he felt disconnected while walking down the ramp at WrestleMania 37. It's not that he lost his passion for pro wrestling, but it's just that he needed something different. Bryan was having an internal battle as his contract in WWE was about to expire and he was wondering whether he wanted to stay in WWE or go to AEW. Bryan was on the fence of what to do until he saw AEW's tribute show for Mr. Brody Lee, and that was when he decided that he wanted to go to AEW, and so he rejected a big money offer from WWE. WWE then announced a match of Bryan versus Roman Reigns with the stipulation that if Bryan loses, he could never return to SmackDown again. Bryan lost this match, and Bryan Danielson's contract did run out in WWE. This is the moment where fans started speculating that Bryan was AEW bound. About a month later, this was further backed up by many reports from reputable wrestling journalists that said that Bryan was indeed going to AEW. These reports came out around the same time that reports were circulating that CM Punk was headed to AEW. CM Punk had debuted in AEW, and on his second week in the company, the fans were chanting yes, 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 over and over again, and CM Punk said this.
That's somebody else's shtick, and you might just need to be a little bit more patient, okay?
Just like that, it was all but confirmed that the American Dragon, Bryan Danielson, was going to AEW for sure. But now, the question was when. At AEW's All Out 2022 in Chicago, a lot of fans had expected Bryan Danielson to make his debut in AEW. However, throughout the whole show, he didn't make an appearance. After the main event of AEW's All Out, between Kenny Omega and Christian Cage, of which Kenny Omega won, while Kenny Omega, The Elite, and the freshly debuted Adam Cole were bidding adieu to the fans, the classic start of the Ride of the Valkyries transitioned into a hip-hop rendition, and the American Dragon Bryan Danielson walked out with a gigantic smile to a monstrous pop. The crowd were going absolutely bananas at the sight of Bryan Danielson, and a chorus of yes chants broke out across the arena. He proceeded to lay out The Elite. This was not televised, but after this he hopped on the mic and he said that he came to AEW for three reasons. First, being that he wanted to wrestle all the incredible talent in AEW. Second, the rabid fans who are genuinely excited about the product. Third, being simply because he's a wrestler. Bryan didn't expand too much on this in respect to WWE, but what he most likely meant by this was that WWE was sports entertainment, where he had limitations with regards to how he should wrestle and what he should say. But AEW is a wrestling first company, where wrestling is portrayed in its purest form with no limitations, and that's what he as a wrestler appreciates. Bryan was not trying to bury WWE by saying all of this. Bryan loved WWE. There was no malice in him leaving WWE. He simply wanted a new challenge in a different environment that's more suited for him. You could clearly see that there was a stark change in Bryan Danielson in AEW. When he arrived in AEW, he said that he wasn't here to uplift younger talent, but mainly to kick some heads in and prove that he's the best. And to prove that he's the best, he immediately went gunning for the best, the AEW world champion at the time, Kenny Omega. Bryan and Kenny had previously wrestled each other on the independent circuit. Since then, they had both morphed into arguably two of the best and most influential wrestlers of the modern era. Danielson was pushing hard for a match, and Kenny Omega was resistant. Bryan Danielson was questioning whether Kenny Omega was still the best bout machine, and whether he was actually the god of pro wrestling like he had been proclaiming. This played on Kenny Omega's insecurities, and he eventually caved in and accepted Bryan Danielson's match. This all set up Kenny Omega and Bryan Danielson's match at AEW's Grand Slam, which was AEW's highest capacity show in front of 20,000 people in New York City's Arthur Ashe Stadium. This match kicked off dynamite and was not for the AEW World Championship. This was a dream match for many fans, so understandably there was a lot of pressure on these two men to deliver, and boy did they knock it out of the park. The atmosphere in the Arthur Ashe Stadium was absolutely electrifying. As the bell rung and the two men were standing across from each other, the crowd let out an absolutely massive roar. As the two stared each other down, Bryan Danielson couldn't help but let out a huge smile. In this moment, you knew immediately that you were seeing something special. These two wrestled a phenomenal match with many memorable moments and spots. During this match, fans were exposed to a Bryan Danielson that they hadn't really seen in many years, as he was truly in his wrestling element while wrestling Kenny Omega. This match was rated 5 stars in the Wrestling Observer newsletter by Dave Meltzer. Unfortunately, the match ended in a 30-minute time limit draw, but that 30 minutes really felt like 5 minutes as time just flew by. This match could have gone on for 60 plus minutes and no one would mind because it was that good. The best thing about this feud is that it's not over. It was only chapter 1 of their story. Danielson continued to hit the ground running in AEW, as the very next week he had a barn burner of a match against Nick Jackson and Bryan picked up the win. Fans were then given a dream bout that they didn't know they needed in Minoru Suzuki versus Danielson. This match was a hard-hitting wrestling clinic that fans loved every second of. Bryan even got rocked by one of Suzuki's forearms. Bryan ended up picking up the win in this match. Danielson then entered the Eliminator Tournament, which is a knockout-style tournament in which the winner gets an AEW World title shot. In the first round, he defeated Dustin Rhodes in an excellent match. In the second round, Bryan faced off against Eddie Kingston, and both Bryan Danielson and Kingston have a very real history with each other that stretches back years. Eddie Kingston genuinely doesn't like Bryan because he judged him on the independent circuit. In defense, Bryan said that he only judged Eddie because he saw the potential in him. Their semi-final eliminator match was brutal as hell, and it felt more like an actual fight than a wrestling match. Bryan's chest was bloodshot red due to the ferocity of Eddie's chops. Bryan managed to pick up the win. Bryan then faced Miro in the final of the eliminator tournament. At AEW's Full Gear 2021, Miro initially replaced John Moxley in the beginning of the tournament because John Moxley had to attend rehab for his alcoholism. Clearly, the tournament finals were supposed to be Moxley versus Bryan, but nonetheless, Miro and Bryan wrestled an excellent match, and Bryan Danielson once again proved that he could have a really good match with anyone. Bryan picked up the win, and he was entitled to a shot at the AEW World Champion, who had won the AEW World Championship on that same night. Because Hangman had insane babyface momentum, he needed a heel to go up against. Bryan turned heel when he encountered Hangman. Bryan subtly buried Hangman by saying that he wished that he had faced Kenny Omega instead of Hangman for the AEW World Championship, and he hurled many subtle digs at Hangman. In the following weeks, Bryan dug even deeper into his heel persona as he faced Hangman's entourage, the Dark Order, and absolutely destroyed and humiliated them. First, Bryan beat Evil Uno by putting him to sleep. Then Bryan beat Colt Cabana while knocking out his teeth and showing off to the camera and the crowd. Bryan then beat Allen Angels and legitimately damaged and strained his MCL in his knee, which led to Angels having to take some time off. That's how vicious Bryan was. Bryan then embarrassed John Silver by beating him in his hometown. Bryan had successfully nerfed the majority of the Dark Order in a malicious manner, and Hangman was next. This set up their match for the AEW World Championship at AEW's Winter is Coming 2021. This match was highly anticipated, but Bryan and Hangman did more than hit it out the park. They hit the ball into the stratosphere. This match was a storytelling epic, filled with many moments that left you on the edge of your seat. Bryan busted Hangman Adam Page open. This match was rated 5 stars by Dave Meltzer in the Wrestling Observer newsletter, which is Bryan's second 5-star match in AEW. This might have just been arguably the best TV match in AEW history. This match went to a 60-minute time limit draw, but the 60 minutes just flew right by. This match was very well received by the fans, and it set up their second match perfectly. In their second match, there would be 3 ringside judges to determine the winner if it were to go the distance once again. The second match was really good, but obviously not as good as the first match, but nonetheless still had many memorable moments and spots. Both Bryan and Hangman were busted open during this match. Unfortunately, Bryan could not pick up the win, and Hangman retained. Bryan's matches with Hangman will go down as some of the very best in AEW history. Before Bryan joined AEW, there were questions as to whether he could hang with all the fast-paced younger talent. But Bryan exceeded expectations by having a truly hot run when he got to AEW. The AEW version of Bryan was much more fiery, and his matches were much better than they were in WWE. Bryan Danielson truly felt at home in AEW. He had reached new heights, but what was next? Soon after Full Gear, John Moxley returned from rehab, and he was looking healthier and happier than ever. Bryan, however, wanted a piece of Moxley, but he didn't want to fight him, and he wanted to be beside him in combat. Bryan had a vision that both of them together could take over AEW and uplift young lions in the process. John Moxley was hesitant, and he told Bryan that he doesn't stand side by side with anyone until he bleeds with them first. Just like that, Mox and Bryan had a match set up for AEW's Revolution 2022. This match was expected to be brutal and bloody, and Bryan and Mox made sure to make the match live up to their expectations. In this match, they busted each other open, which meant that they were bleeding together. John Moxley picked up the win, but soon after this match, the two started brawling. Then suddenly, William Regal, who has been a genuine mentor in both of their careers, walked out and played peacemaker in a violent way by slapping them both and forcing them to shake hands. Thus, the Blackpool Combat Club was born, and they were looking for violence. They soon brought in Wheeler Yuta, who had had matches against Bryan and Moxley in which they brutalized him, but that was them just making him tough in order for him to join the Blackpool Combat Club, and these matches made Yuta a star. The Blackpool Combat Club are a group of calloused individuals who are badasses, and their shtick is to inflict as much pain as humanly possible onto their opponents. They are some sadistic motherfuckers. The Blackpool Combat Club, with William Regal as their manager, went on to brutalize a number of different opponents. At this point, Eddie Kingston was feuding with Chris Jericho, and John Moxley of the Blackpool Combat Club was one of Eddie's best friends in AEW. So naturally, John Moxley got involved in Eddie, Santana, and Ortiz's feud with Chris Jericho and the Jericho Appreciation Society, and he brought the Blackpool Combat Club along with him. This sounds all right on the surface, but remember that Bryan Danielson is on the Blackpool Combat Club, and Bryan and Eddie legitimately hate each other, as history shows. And it showed, as there were problems between the two in their feud against the Jericho Appreciation Society. The Anarchy in the Arena match was then announced at AEW's Double or Nothing 2022. Between the Jericho Appreciation Society and the Blackpool Combat Club, Bryan and Eddie were on the same team, and this made for an intriguing affair. The Anarchy in the Arena match was nothing like we'd ever seen in wrestling before. It was a true spectacle, as all the men in the match battled across different points of the arena in bloody messes. It was arguably the best match on the card that night, and was rated 5 stars in the Wrestling Observer newsletter, which was Bryan Danielson's third 5-star match in AEW. Bryan even said one of his early Ring of Honor catchphrases in this match. At the end of this match, Bryan had Chris Jericho in a submission, and a heavily bloodied Eddie Kingston came down to the ring with gasoline in hand, with the intention to kayfabe kill Chris Jericho. Eddie then proceeded to pour it over Chris Jericho while he was in Bryan's submission. Eddie was about to light up Chris Jericho, but then Bryan knocked the lighter out of his hand, and a fight between them ensued. This allowed the Jericho Appreciation Society to take advantage, and unfortunately, Bryan Danielson took the pin in this match, and the Jericho Appreciation Society stood tall. However, something concerning happened to Bryan during this match. He suffered a concussion that caused him to miss AEW and New Japan's Forbidden Door, where he was supposed to go up against Zack Sabre Jr. in order to determine who the best technical wrestler in the world is. Claudio Castagnoli ended up replacing him. Bryan's concussion is actually very concerning because of his history of concussions. It usually takes about 7 to 14 days to heal a concussion, but at the time of this recording, Danielson's concussion recovery has lasted over 6 weeks. All we can do is hope that he's okay and wait for his return. But that's Bryan Danielson's story so far. Every iteration of Bryan Danielson has been passionate, and you can tell he has so much love for the art of pro wrestling. He has changed wrestling time and time again with his amazing wrestling ability and his connection with the fans. Above all else, he's a good human being, and that's what really matters. Thank you for watching the video. Please like, share, comment, and subscribe. But anyway, goodbye, you jobbers.